as long as it's horizontal, tilt it a bit, we'll get less strain. So what counts for you, it's the normal lines to the surface. This is the flux. This flux, which is an evaluation of the magnetic line of force, is measured in Weber. The SI unit is Weber. Each Weber is 10 to the power 8 line of force. And each Weber is 100 million lines. And the next term, if this is understood, is the flux density. You do care when you dealing with magnetic system about the density. Maybe the number of this line, the flux, doesn't have a meaning for you. You care about how much you will have from this line per unit area. This is the magnetic flux, which is given that symbol B. So magnetic flux density, B, is the line force per unit area. Most of the system, whether this magnet or this magnet, if you purchase it, you purchase it based on the Tesla, which is Weber per meter square. Even MRI machine, the power of the machine is given in Tesla. Tesla is Weber per meter square. So we do care when we evaluate the magnetic system about the magnetic flux density, which is how much is lines you have per unit area. Well, this is important to give you an idea about the strength of the magnetic system. As an example, to make the idea clear, we have magnetic field around our planet, the Earth. The magnetic flux density of this magnetic field of the Earth is around 50 microtesla. Why, for typical MRI machine, it's around 3 tesla. If I put my thumb on my index like this, this area is around 1 inch square. If this area is in the magnetic field of the Earth, only 4 lines of magnetic force will be passing through this area. 4 lines from the magnetic field of the Earth. If I put the same area in the MRI machine, I will be having 240,000 lines passing through this area. So magnetic flux density is important as a measurement of the magnetic system, measured in Weber per meter square, which is equivalent to Tesla. Another thing we measure the magnetic field is the magnetic field intensity. Density, intensity. Intensity is sometimes good for us because it's dependent on the current in the symbol H. And if the magnetic field density is the line of the magnetic lines per unit area, here it's per unit length. The magnetic field density is the strength per unit length. Sometimes there are confusion between magnetic field density and magnetic field intensity. One of them is density per unit area, the other is intensity per unit length. Normally, these magnetic field around the conductor will be in circles. So we follow the circle, the path of the circle, and per meter we can measure the magnetic field intensity, which is H. Now, if you have conductor, there will be magnetic field around the conductor. At the center of the conductor, you have the highest, and whenever you go away from that, the magnetic field will be less and less. For that reason, in electrical system, they use turns, windings. Because when you make one winding like this one, and you apply the right-hand rule, you'll find that most of the magnetic field is now constrained inside this turn. As if you are collecting the magnetic field instead of being around the conductor, weak and weaker, inside this term. That's why machines and power system are using windings. So if you have current passing through this term, for example, it will produce phi. It will produce magnetic flux. Now, if you have so many terms, this flux will be linking all the terms. there's another term which we call flux linkage. In order to find the flux linkage, you just only multiply this by the number of links. So flux linkage, from the definition, wasliyat image analysis, it's only the number of term multiplied by phi, n phi. If this flux linkage, n phi, you divide it by the current, you'll get the inductance. This is our subject. We are looking for this inductance by this formula, dividing the flux linkage by the current. And in transmission line, we don't have these terms. If you remember, we consider the transmission line is only one term as part of one term with infinite radius. So normally, whenever we have lambda, it will be same as phi, except inside the conductor. It will be part of a term. We'll see how we'll get this, as also we explained last time, it will be a ratio from phi. But other than outside the conductor, flux linkage is phi, because n is one. For that reason, as I told you, if you want to understand the procedure of derivation, this thing for understanding is to go in the opposite direction, backwards, because we follow the steps to derive the inductance of transmission line. These steps was based on the station at the end, because this station at the end needs lambda, the flux linkage, and if you divide this flux linkage by the current, you will get the inductance of the transmission line. To find lambda, now I'll go backwards. To find lambda, I have to find lambda now is the flux. We said lambda flux linkage is n phi. So n is one outside the conductor, less than one inside the conductor. So I need phi. In order to find the inductance, I need to divide the flux linkage by the current. Flux linkage is related to phi, so I need phi. Phi, if I need phi, it's related, as we explained, to the flux density. Because if I know the flux density, I multiply it by the area, I get the flux. How can I find the flux density? One simple thing is the magnetic flux intensity. Because magnetic flux intensity is related to the current. It's simply the current divided by the length of the path, L. L normally will be the circular path around the conductor, which is 2 by R. So I know I know the dimensions. If I can get H, then easily there's a relation between H and B, relation between magnetic field intensity and magnetic field density, which is B equal mu H. A mu is the permeability, and the magnetism. Its analogy in the electrical system is the conductivity. We have conductivity in electrical system, here we have permeability. We give it the simple mu. A mu is consisting of two parts, mu naught, mu r. Mu naught is the permeability of the free space, mu r is the relative permeability of the system. Based on this first introduction, now we'll go to the last lecture. We review it fast, but remember these things. We are looking for the inductance. We want to get an expression for the inductance. Inductance, by definition, is the flux linkage divided by the current. Flux linkage is lambda equals n phi. So keep this in mind while we are reviewing the last lecture. Now we started from this. This is a cross section of the conductor. And as you can see, the radius of the conductor is R. And we want to evaluate now to get H. Remember, we go backward, we get H. Then we get B. From B, we get the flux. Then till the flux, we can get the flux linkage divided by the current, we get the inductance. So the first thing is to get the magnetic flux intensity, which is simply, as we define it, it's the current by the length of the path of the magnetic field. Now here, this conductor, as you can see, it has radius r, and we'll select the point inside the conductor with radius x. And then we'll integrate, this is the surface integral for hx around the circular path, which is y x. It's very simple. You integrate from 0 to x, x dl, you will get 2 by x, hx equals ix. Hx is very simple, ix divided by 2 by x. Magnetic field intensity equal the current divided by the length of the path. The length of the path, the circular path with radius x, is 2 by x. I will divide the current in this portion, in this tube inside the conductor, by the length of the magnetic path. This is hx. Now, if you look at this one, the small tube which has radius x, if you compare the two areas, this area of x to the total area, it is by x squared over by r. Ratio between the area of the small tube inside the conductor to the total area is by x squared divided by r. So the current, if the current is uniform, it will be prorated percentage of that. Multiply this ratio by the total current, you'll get Ix. Now, this Ix, substitute it up for Ix, you'll get Hx equal x over 2 by r squared multiplied by r. Now, remember, we are going in the reverse direction to understand why you are doing this. You put the magnetic field intensity H, from which we can get the magnetic flux density B. So B is equal to mu multiplied by H. Hx. The previous value, this for Hx, you just multiply it by mu. Mu is the permeability. Now, phi, again, when you get B, you got the magnetic field density, flux per unit area. If you multiply by the area, you will get the flux. We are looking for the flux because this is what we are seeking. So if I multiply bx by the area, I will get the flux. But this area is bx, as you can see, multiplied by the length of the conductor. Yani if this is the conductor and this is delta x, as you can see, this is here in the circular path. We took delta x, I multiplied by the length of the conductor, this cross-sectional area. So I don't now, for as we explained, for transmission line, we're doing everything this parameter. Even manufacturer's data sheet has these parameters for resistance, for inductance, for the capacitance per meter. So I multiply only by dx, I will get the flux per meter. You can see here that the flux is given as Weber per meter. Flux is Weber, but I'm taking it focus here per meter, because if you want to get the flux from B, you have to multiply it by area. B is the flux divided by unit area. Instead of multiplying by the area, I multiply only by delta x and leave the length and give it as Weber per meter as d phi. Now we said that for lambda, it's for transmission line, flux linkage is n phi. Outside the conductor, at the surface of the conductor, we have only one term. But inside the conductor, for this tube inside the conductor, we'll take it a percentage. So flux linkage, lambda, will be portion of that phi, which is the same thing dividing the circle, the area of the small circle, to the total area of the conductor. By x squared divided by r squared, we multiply it by d phi. This is the flux, the concept, the definition of flux linkage, because flux linkage is wasliya til majal manatis. For this small area, it's portion ratio-wise to the total area of the conductor. Multiply this by d phi, you put it up, you are coming with this one. Mu multiplied by x cubed, I divided by 2 by r to the 4, dx. This is d lambda, differential value of lambda. Now, if you integrate it, remember that lambda internal, we are calculating the internal, because as you remember, this inductance has two parts, internal and external. So for this, if you integrate this one, if you integrate it, it's easy. You have the integration relative to x, any other thing is constant. So it will be, I will integrate x, x to the 4 divided by 4, we will get mu I divided by 8 bar. Now, that's what we want. That's what we are looking for, the inductance. So we will divide the flux linkage by the current. If you divide by the current, we will get mu over 8 bar. Now, for the non-ferromagnetic materials, we said that mu is equal to mu naught to mu r. For non-ferromagnetic materials, this mu r is almost 1. If you check the table, for not only any for copper or aluminium, even for water, for other things, you'll find that is around 1. You find it for one material is 0.9999, for another one, 1.0037. It's almost very close to 1. So we can replace mu by mu naught. You will be getting mu naught over 8 pi, and mu naught is as the value, is very known in electrical system, magnetic system, 4 pi times 10 to the power minus 7. This is 0.5 times 10 to the power of minus 7. This is the internal inductance of the ion, and see here, it's bare meter. This is the internal inductance. We are now done with the internal inductance of the ion. Now we'll move to the external inductance. For external inductance, we'll take two points outside the conductor and we'll try to find the inductance between these two points. One of them is P1 at a distance D1 from the center of the conductor. The other one is P2 at a distance of D2 from the center of the conductor. This conductor has magnetic flux lines around it. So we want to see how much the inductance outside this conductor. This is the conductor. I want to find the inductance between two points, P1 and P2. I will select a point between these two, let's say X. The same philosophy, the same approach, HX magnetic field intensity is the current divided by the length of the path. The length of the path, again, is 2 by X, but now X is outside the conductor. All the current will be included. So IX is basically is I. Before we were inside the conductors, you took a portion. IX was smaller than I, and it was a ratio from I by the area of the path it took. But here, all the current is enclosed. So IX is basically I. Very simple thing, magnetic field. Intensity is the current divided by 2 by x. Next thing, immediately, you find magnetic field intensity, you get B. B is simply mu multiplied by H. That expression at the top, I over 2 by x, you multiply it by mu, you get B. Now phi, again, with the same philosophy, we said phi is B multiplied by the area. But if I want by unit length, I multiply it only by incremental of dx. This will give us the expression for d phi. Lambda equal d phi because only we have one term in the transmission line, n is 1 outside the conductor. So the same expression for d phi we got, it's the same as for d lambda. Now, again, you integrate, but our integration now is from d1 to d2, different from the internal inductance, which we take it from the center to r. If you integrate with respect to x, so everything is constant, but as if you are having dx by x. Integration of dx by x is the natural logarithm, ln. So you take the constant part, mu I over 2y, ln x from d1 to d2, which is, if you substitute, will be ln d1 over d2. This is the external value of the inductance. So far everything is clear. I'm just reviewing what we said in the last lecture. I didn't start with a new subject. So everything is clear. Okay. Once we got lambda, it's easy to get the inductance. Divide the flux linkage by the current, you get the inductance. So if you do this, you just remove I from the expression of lambda, and the inductance, external inductance, will be given as mu divided by 2 by ln d2 over d1. We'll move to one more example. By the way, at the end, when we take so many inductors, you will find everything is simple. Just now try to understand the physics. At the end, you will see whatever we'll be having so many examples. We will be maybe 4 or 5 numerical examples too, and you will see it's very simple. All of them, whatever the number of the conductors, the phases, the bundling, whatever, will be reduced to simple formula. what you have to understand and to follow now the physics, so that you get the question, you can easily translate it to proper equation. So now we want to find the inductance of a single phase two-wire system. This one, as you can see, you have two conductors. One of them, as you see, there is a cross and the other is dot. And we explained this before. The convention for direction of current from the dart, if it's away from you, you will see the cross. If it's towards you, you will see the dot. So for these conductors, they are having the same current, space by distance d, and we want to find the inductance between them. Let's select one point and try to do the same procedure. Again, the same simple formula. Hx, the magnetic flux intensity at point x or at any point, is the surface integral along the circular path of the magnetic flux. Now, you have two parts. You have internal and external. For the internal, you remember we come to it as mu over 8 pi. We put it in this formula, but the first part is mu over 8 pi, the term that we did for the internal inductance. For the external inductance, it will be distance d over r. V over r here, since the current is the same, but in opposite direction, outside the conductor, the other conductor, outside H2, the total net current is zero, so there's no contribution to the flux linkage. So that it's between one conductor and the other. Now, this formula will simplify it later more, but it is the basic principle, internal and external inductance. Now let's see what is the import of this formula, what does it tell us, and then we'll go one step further to simplify it. Simplify means mathematical implementation only. Basic principle is this one. Now suppose that you are comparing the 11 kilovolt with the 400 kilovolt. Always understood that whenever you go higher with the voltage, you need to make the spacing between the line more to keep a proper insulation. So now D, the distance between the conductors in the 11 kilovolt, is much smaller than that for the 400 kilovolt. Based on that, for the 11 kilovolt, the inductance is much less than the 400 kilovolt network, because you saw that D is up and it's directly proportional to D, and whenever you go higher, the inductance will be higher. One more comparison between the underground cable, buried underground cable, and overhead lines. You can see for any underground cables, the distance between the conductors is less than that for the overhead line. So the inductance of the buried cables is less than that of overhead lines. These simple things are important. Sometimes so many questions, multiple choice, will ask you about that. The only thing that you have to understand is this simple formula, which shows you what is the relation with D and what is the relation with the R, which is the cross-section area of the conductor, opposite to each other. This is one example of bundled conductor. When you do bunting for the conductor, as if you're increasing the cross-section area of the conductor. We'll come to this later. We'll see this, we'll call it like geometric mean radius of the conductor. But it can now be easy understood that when you have three conductors instead of as if you're increasing the area. When you increase the area, you are increased R. R, increasing R will drop the inductance. So bundling is reducing the inductance of the transmission line. This is one advantage of bundling. These different shapes, these different comparisons between overhead lines, different voltages, 11 kilovolt, 400 kilovolt, bundled conductors, all of this are based on this simple formula, whereas D is at the top and R at the bottom. Anything will increase D will increase the inductance. Anything will increase the R will decrease the inductance. There's all this comparison based on this simple formula. This inductance, as we said before, it's inherent of the conductor. It will never change. But when it comes to reactance, reactance is dependent on the system frequency. And if we multiply the angle of frequency omega, which is 2 by f, by the inductance, we'll be getting the reactance. All our calculations were based in reactance, inductance per meter. So here x1 is the reactance per meter. If the, I think something happened to the network. Is the sound now is okay? Now here, don't bother about these things. This is only mathematical simplification. The same expression that we got for L, which sum both internal and external inductance, we can put it in another form. And for example, this 1/4, we can put it as ln e to the 4. This mathematical relation, ln e to the power 1/4, you can take the 1/4 outside the ln, ln e is 1. So it's only just simplifying the equation. So if you put 1/4 in this form, you can put all of them together. You have d on top, and down there is r. Take the e to the 4 down, it will be e to the minus 4th, and you will substitute for mu naught, mu r, all simple mathematical formulas till you get this. Sorry, I think that the connection was lost. I connected to another network. So we reach this point. Sorry, I think maybe for a moment the connection was lost. I connected to another network. Now this is only mathematical simplification. We'll lead that the inductance equal 4 times 10 to the minus 7 ln d over r dash, where r dash is defined by r e to the minus 4th. This is the inductance per loop meter transmission line. Now another example, take this two conductor, each one having current in opposite direction. Remember that based on the right-hand rule, you can deduct the direction of the magnetic field around the conductor. If the fingers are in the direction of the current, the thumb will be towards the north direction of the magnetic field. So since the two currents here are in the opposite direction, one of the magnetic field will be counterclockwise, one of them will be clockwise. From where, from which point shall I repeat? From here? Okay, for this part, I'm repeating this for this only mathematical simplification. The same, we concluded that we have internal and external inductance given by the simple formula mu over pi multiplied by 1/4 plus ln d over r. This means simplification. It doesn't give any extra information. For this to be written in a simpler formula, we took the 1/4, replace it by ln e to the power 4th, because ln e to the power 1/4, you can take the 1/4 outside the ln. So 1/4 multiplied by ln e. Ln e is 1, it's the same as 4. We put it just in this way to get simpler expression to remember. If you put it like this, now you have ln a plus ln b. Ln a plus b means ln ab. So you take the mu over pi outside the bracket. Ln d r is down. You take the e to the 4th down, e minus 4th. This the reason for this simplification is to have only relation between the distance and radius. Distance and radius. On top there is d distance, down r, this is like geometrical radius. We'll come to this later, which is r e to the minus 4th. You know mu equal mu r mu naught. Mu naught is 4 pi multiplied by 10 to the minus 7. This can be further simplified then to be L equals 4 times 10 to the minus 7 ln d over r dash. This is only mathematical simplification. The reason why we did this, because we want, as you will see later, as I told you, whatever the number of conductors, now we'll take a k number of conductors. At the end, you will find only you have only similar formula, where will you have d at the top and r the radius at the bottom. D and r will be different mathematical calculation. We call them geometrical mean radius and geometrical mean distance when you have so many conductors scattered. But this is to show you that all of them, as you will see, we take so many examples, as I said, so many examples we take numerical for so many different types of conductors, bundled conductors, equilateral, for conduct. We'll take this, all these examples, but you will notice in all these examples that it's only one simple formula. The only thing is that how mathematically, as if I'm searching for the equivalent distance for these scattered conductors and the equivalent radius. This equivalent distance, we call it geometrical mean distance, and the equivalent radius is geometrical mean radius. It's asking which equation exactly you use in the problems. As I told you, we'll be solving maybe 5 or 6 problems. Equations, all of the equations will be similar to one equation. We'll start driving it for k conductors. Similar, it's not exactly, but similar to the expression that we saw. We'll see how we'll solve the problem by selecting the distance, or evaluating the distance, geometrical mean distance or geometrical mean radius. Both of them will be based on this simple formula, as you will see. So just wait a little, when we reach the example, I will give you a hint that you will which one we will use. Now for two conductor line inductance, here two conductors, each having current in opposite direction. So based on the right hand rule, if I put my fingers in the direction of the thumb will pointing to the north pole of the magnetic field. So because the current here is in opposite direction, one of the magnetic field will be counterclockwise, the other will be clockwise. I will take a point, I call it outside the two conductors. I'm taking a point outside the two conductors. This point is R, where I will be evaluating, integrating in this direction. I want to see the magnetic field at this point R from these two conductors. One of them will be at the reference point, the left one. Then there is d distance between them. This R is greater than double the distance. Why double that? It's just only to show that when you are at distance much higher than the separation between the two conductors, you can consider it at infinity. But for the time, we'll come to this, but for the time being, these are two conductors. I'm looking to find the inductance at R outside the conductors. Now we'll do superposition. Superposition, as you recall from electric circuits and any system, superposition means I will take the effect of one conductor as if the other conductor is not there, then I will go to the other conductor, take it alone, and then after that I group them together. So for the first conductor, it's the same formula that we got, mu naught over 2 by I ln. Now I want the distance over the radius. The distance is R. My reference point is the center of the left conductor. So I am at a distance R from that conductor. I have to have a reference. I can take any reference. I can take the second conductor. I can take any point in the space. But for simplicity, we do it like this, but we have to stick with the reference. Reference is reference. So I am at distance R from the center of this conductor. So distance R over the R dash. R dash is radius multiplied by e to the minus fourth, which we can call it geometrical magnitude. This is for the left part. Forget about the left part. Now take the right part as if it's only there. So you are now, your distance is r minus d. Suppose that you are traveling on the x-axis, so you are at r. You want to measure the distance between r and the second conductor, the one on the right. It will be r minus d. The radius now will be relative to the origin. Origin is the left conductor. So now the radius, as if the radius is d. It's r, basically it's r, but relative to the origin, it's d, because this is your reference point. So now you put the two parts of the equation. One of them is I, the other is minus I, because they have the current in opposite direction. You can simplify this till simplification means length always for this, because we are dealing with len AB equal len A plus len B, len OA over B equals len A minus len B, and so on. So the simplification is like this. For example, len r over r is len r minus len r dash, and so on for the other, till you reach mu naught over 2 by I len d over r dash plus len r over r minus d. Now, if r, as we said, approaches infinity, always infinity doesn't mean infinity, doesn't mean we are at infinity. It means that if the distance r is much higher than the distance between the two conductors, to the extent that we consider it at infinity. So if r will go to infinity, r over r minus d, it will be 1. You are left with len 1, which is 0. So the second part will be completely removed. You are left with the left part, which is mu naught over 2 by len d over r dash. Again, as you can see, easily you are coming to the same formula. Mu naught is the constant over 2 by, but it's len d over r dash. Len, the distance over the geometrical main radius, the radius. Now we'll come to multi-conductors, which will be the case for the problem that just about the problems. We'll be having so many types of circuits, lines running vertical, horizontal, single circuit, double circuit, bundle, three bundle, four bundle. You see at the end, it will be reaching a very simple formula. The only thing that you have to understand the geometry of the conductance, where you will get the geometrical main distance and geometrical main radius. That equation will be the same. Don't worry, we have so many examples. The only thing that you try to understand the physics now, so that when you have a question, a problem, you can see how you will start. Now these conductors are in the space. As you can see, there's I1, I2, IN, IK, whatever. We want to find inductance for these conductors, which is the case in transmission line. As you saw in the transmission line design, there are so many configurations, single circuit, double circuit, two lines in the bundle, three, four, etc. The simplest thing to do is we put our coordinates and we bring conductor one, put it in the origin as a reference. I'll repeat the last part because the network was disconnecting. Now we said we have so many conductors, I1, I2, I3, IN, IK. We want to find inductance for these multi-conductors. The best thing to do is to, first thing, to locate our coordinates. And we'll bring one conductor, we'll name it conductor one, put it on the origin. This is our reference. And we'll bring another conductor, any conductor, and this is space around this conductor, with, let's say, conductor K, with current IK. Again, there's any conductor, because if we put our conductor one, and the reference in the origin, and find an expression for IK, wherever IK, I'm getting lambda one, or inductance for conductor one. This we can be applied to any other conductor. So I'll put IK. This IK, this conductor K, has magnetic field around it, circles around it. Whenever you go further, there is always circles. One circle will have lambda one, concept we will have, lambda 2 for example, lambda 3, and so on. This conductor which we are seeking the effect of its magnetic field on our conductor, our reference conductor, conductor number 1, has so many magnetic field circuits around it. I will select point R1 on the x-axis to find the inductance at that point. We suppose that the magnetic circuit which passes through this R1 is number 4, as only an M. This conductor here has so many circuits, magnetic circuits around it. Lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3 for this R1, suppose lambda 4. Also there will be lambda 5 and so on. Now, the distance between R1 and the conductor K, I will name it RK. Distance between R1 and the conductor K is RK. The distance between conductor 1 and conductor K is D1K. If you follow that circle, this also will be D1K. And this is D1K and also this is D1K. It's the radius of the same circle, this one and this one. I'll name this point A, this point intersection of D1K with the circle A, this point B, and that point at point RC. This is my schematic diagram that I will study to find the inductance of one conductor relative to conductor 1. In order to follow well, I will repeat these steps from the beginning so that you can follow what we are doing. We are having so many conductors scattered in the space. We want to find the effect of one conductor to the other. If we find an expression for that, we can apply it to all the conductors. Best thing to do is I will select my coordinate, x, y axis for example, and put my conductor number 1, the conductor which I want to be under study and the reference in the origin, and I will select another conductor in the space around this conductor. This conductor IK has magnetic field with circles of magnetic field around it, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, and so on. I will select a point on the x-axis, I call it R1. This R1 as intersects with one circle around the conductor K, any circle. B and R1, there is also other lambda, for whatever. So these are circles around the conductor K. I selected R1, which lies on one of them. This R1 has distance RK between it and conductor K. Also, between K and conductor 1, there is distance D1K. And these things, symbols are easy. Distance between conductor 1 and conductor K is D1K. It's the same as this one, D1K. This one and this one. They are on the same circle. Now I will name this point A, this intersection, this point B, and the point at R is C. So this is my schematic to study for the multi conductors. Now I want to find expression for, as we did before, for the flux linkage lambda. Now I'm focusing on lambda 1 for conductor number 1, which I put in the origin as a reference. This will have a mu naught over 2 pi, the common factor, plus terms. These terms, first of them is R1 over the radius. I will say radius, but it's basically the geometrical mean radius, because it's R1 multiplied by e to the minus 4th. But I will say radius. Since R, the first term, the first term, R1 over the radius, other terms will be R2, for example, over D12, R3 over D1, and so on. Till I reach RK, for example, D1K, RN, D1N. And you saw this in this diagram, D1K, or you can apply it to any other conductors. So what does this mean? This means that this lambda, this flux linkage, has the first part, which is, call it the internal or the self, for the conductor, and other terms are based on other conductors, how they are related to it, R2 over D12, R3, and so on. Now, again, mathematical, we'll take, we will split this into two terms. One of them, I will keep the R1 dash D12 as 1 over, and take R1, R2, R3, R5, Rn, etc. to as another term. What I did here, only splitting the ln, we have ln A over B, as it will be ln A minus ln B. Suppose that R, as we said before, goes to infinity. If R goes to infinity, I can even simplify the second term, which is mu naught over 2 by R is infinity means R1, R2, R3 are equal. I will get the term mu naught over 2 by multiplied by the summation from j equal 1 to n ij. This I1, I2, I4, In, I will sum them in this summation. So the second term, I split it mathematically into this term. Since, how did I do this? R, when R goes to infinity, no difference between R1, R2, R3, R5, R100. All of them will be the same. So I'll replace any R with R1. So it will, then R1 will be common between R1. I'm talking about only the second term. Well, I have constant mu naught over 2 pi. Then I have summation I1 plus I2 plus I3 plus I4, I5 till In. So this is like summation of the current from J1 to N. And for any balanced three-phase system, the summation of the current is zero. For any balanced three-phase system, the summation of the current is zero. Take this for example, this three-phase system. Here, the current passing through the neutral is zero. As long as the load is balanced, the current is zero. This can be easily mathematically explained because these currents are 120 degrees apart. If you take them as IA, IB, IC, one of them angle zero, the other second one is 120, third one is 240. We took them as unity one. Each one is cosine angle plus J sine the angle. If you do this mathematically, you will reach that the summation of the current zero. So this term, the summation of the current that we reach for balanced three-phase system, it will be zero. This one, summation of J1 to N of IJ will be zero. This will cancel the second term. Now, if this is zero, we'll be left only with the first part of the equation. Mu naught over 2 pi multiplied by I1, ln 1 over R1 dash, etc., which can be split to first term, only the first term, as you can see, its radius R1 is the self inductance. So this term is self inductance. All other parts are, I give them the name L12, L13, L14, L1n. These are mutual inductance. And even you will see for three phase system, normally the mutual inductance is cancelled. Because when you have three balanced system, they have inductance created from the magnetic field around them. Since the current R, they have summation zero, the magnetic field will be summed to zero. Now we'll take, we'll start with the example. We have so many examples. I think before starting these examples, these examples will show you that how much the things are very simple, very easy. The only thing, as I said, how simple formula, we'll be using the simple same formula. The only thing now it's mathematical thing. I have so many conductors scattered here and there. They have distances between them. I will have find the geometrical mean distance for them. And for the radius, for example, you have four in the bundle, three in the bundle. Each one has a radius, three of them or four of them in the bundle will have geometrical mean radius. Mathematical foundation for this distance and radius will be put in similar equation, we'll get the answer. We have so many different examples for normal phase, for bundle tree phase, for triangle, for four. And then we'll expand it to an example for the resistance plus the inductance. I will leave this to the next lecture. I hope that you review this information. If you have any question, we'll start next time with examples. You will see they are very simple. Even the formulas, you will see they are reduced to very simple formula. But please try to review what we said now today and in the last lecture. Try to find anything is not clear for you. Please don't be shy. Any question regarding how did you get this, how did you give this for the resistance or inductance? Next lecture, I will open the questions. Then we'll start with the examples. Is it okay? Okay, good. I stop here. If anybody has a question, I'm here. Who doesn't, she can leave. Thank you.